cream you, but I feel like I'm a little bit overdressed sitting here, so I'm going to take my jacket off. I might put it on again if it's a bit cold, but please like feel totally free to ask me any questions. And I'm the most intimidated one here, not you, okay? So I'm just going to talk to you about some of my experiences. Have any of you guys seen me before? No? Oh dear, tough crowd. I'm just going to talk you through a few things. I found it incredibly difficult to pitch my lecture because I've got very young guys here and some very senior guys here, and in between it's quite difficult. So I'm just going to start and stop me, and I'm going to talk about a few things here and there and areas of interest to me, if that's reasonable. Good. So we'll talk about the evolution of the modern surgeon. We'll talk about and focus on GRT technology and advancements, and we'll talk about endoscopic progress and laparoscopic progress. And I'll mention a little bit about the robots. Now, I think we all know these kind of pictures, and this was our humble beginnings, where we didn't really know what we were doing much, but we were somewhat involved into not that. Those were the first instruments that we dealt with. But with laparoscopy, so we've gone from open surgery to a little bit more sort of interesting areas of laparoscopy, pushing the boundaries of laparoscopy to not just laparoscopic cholecystectomies and laparoscopic appendicectomies, but to opening up the bile duct, removing major stones and bile ducts, to resecting liver tumors, to pushing the boundaries and doing laparoscopic pancreatic cancer surgery, laparoscopic renal surgery. So there's a whole lot of stuff that's actually happening at the moment, which is evolving, and people have really got pretty advanced with this stuff. You guys are training in an era which is just unbelievable with the burst of technology. I actually really, really, really am jealous of how the times that you're coming in. Don't worry, at some stage you'll sit where I am, and you'll be jealous of the younger guns coming up too. But, you know, we even move further to, besides laparoscopy, to the advent of robotic surgery. And has anybody had any insight into robotic surgery? Does anybody know if we've got a robot in the country? Do we have a robot in the country? Yeah. So there's a robot called the Da Vinci, which is losing its patency license at the moment as we speak, so I think it will get a lot cheaper. But it's mainly used in what field?
Urology.
Urology, yeah. Urologists love this, and I think there's enough evidence now to suggest that the outcomes with robotic surgery are superior to that of laparoscopy and open surgery. So I was privileged 2 years ago to sit in Strasbourg, where I watched a live feed from Hong Kong where the guy did laparoscopic orbitals, I mean a robotic orbitals, and did the pancreatic anastomosis in 15 minutes, which is really unheard of. It's really phenomenal. Now, does anybody know the advantages of a robot as opposed to laparoscopy? So, laparoscopy is like using chopsticks. It's pretty straight, it's pretty rigid, and it's really difficult to sort of move around with, and you've got these kind of movements, up, down, left, right movements. They've developed instruments that articulate a little bit more to help you get around this, but it still isn't as good as your wrist will, because your wrist is amazing. It's got like almost 360 degree movement. And the robot is phenomenal because it's much easier to learn. The learning curve is a lot sort of less steep because you've got very similar movements to your hand movements. The second thing is that you're sitting like I am in a very comfortable position as I'm speaking to you, as opposed to standing all the time with your shoulders up and, you know, in difficult positions, and it's a lot less tiring for the surgeon. Who knows, when you guys are there teaching, maybe most of them will be done in laparoscopic, I mean robotically. What I have to tell you is that I actually attended an update course in Pretoria, and one of the surgeons stood up in the audience and shocked me, because he stood up and said, "We are having a high incidence of bile duct injuries because we don't know how to convert into open cholecystectomies anymore. We've been trained only to laparoscopic cholecystectomies. So when I run into a problem, I don't really know what to do. What is your advice?" And that scared me, because you know, whilst we are progressing so rapidly, there's still aspects to open surgery which is important to maintain and generate. But let's move on a little bit. So this was the first endoscope. It was pretty rigid. And guy was awake, so we make him swallow it like a sword, and then you look down this rigid pipe and you pull out pieces of meat or whatever that was impacted inside there. You can see certain injuries. The problem with this is that you would cause a lot of injuries as well, as you can imagine, perforations. We've somewhat advanced from this, and one of the areas that I like, and I'm sure you guys have seen lots of endoscopy. Have you seen endoscopy? Everybody? Yeah? A lot of people? So we've got different types of endoscopy. So can I ask, if I may, what kind of endoscopy have you seen? I saw a hand up there. Yeah, go for it.
I've seen colonoscopy.
You've seen colonoscopy. Okay, that's wonderful. Have you seen gastroscopies?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, the nice thing about that is that you've got a camera in the front, so you can see where you're going all the time. As opposed to duodenoscopy, where you actually have the camera on the side. The reason why the camera is on the side is because you want to do an ERCP and you want to see the ampulla. And when you get in, the ampulla is on the side. So most of the work that's done needs to be with the camera facing the side. So this is just a picture of a new bulk duodenoscope, and we've gone even further. And we now managed to put a camera within this camera so that we can actually see inside the bowel duct. That's called spyglass. I was instrumental in running a clinical trial to bring it into the country. And this is what it looks like. So here's your normal scope, which you can see here. And as surgeons in South Africa, we're privileged. We're privileged because everywhere else in the world, the endoscopy is done by physicians and medical physicians. Well, we here have to be superb surgeons, open surgeons, laparoscopic surgeons, endoscopists. And we're in a position where we actually have to know some radiology, including ultrasound. Ultrasound becoming like an extension of your hand now in clinical practice. Anyway, getting back to this, is here you see the normal scope that we put down. And we attach this camera here, which is really tiny, which is 3.2 French, which goes down the working channel and has a high definition camera chip on. And through this little tiny sort of system, we're able to take biopsies, put a biopsy forceps of tumors that might be growing within the bile duct or within the pancreatic duct, or we're able to put a laser through that and blast massive stones. You guys heard of this? No? It's okay, don't worry. Can I show you some possible videos of this? Would you like to maybe have a quick view of this? Because I find it quite fascinating myself to watch. And well, first we've got to get down to the ampulla. And once we're down to the ampulla, this is what the ampulla looks like. I'm sorry, I'm going to flick between my movies just to get my idea. So there you can see the ampulla. That's a catheter that we put in, and we're using electricity on a wire to cut the ampulla to open up that valve so we can have access to the duct. As you can see, that can be quite dangerous if it's not done in a controlled environment. You can perforate things. And this is all done in this pocket. And then you see a gush of bile, which is quite beautiful. But sometimes we can't get in there, and we just can't get the guide wire through the correct channel. So we have another device. This is called a needle knife, and I think that it's something worth seeing, how else we can get around this. So we've got the ampulla there, it's bulging, it's huge, it's really making life difficult for us. And here you see a needle knife where I'm actually cutting it horizontally or vertically without anything with that to try and locate that. And it opens up like a flower. And then you see this pink highway or mucosa of the bile duct. You'll see it come through now. There you go. You see that pink mucosa there? That tells you that's the entry to the bile duct. So we get into the bile duct, and once we've got into the bile duct, we can then now put our spy scope inside. And I promise you this is hot off the press, that it's only been in the country for maybe a year now that we've got this in the country. It's still not in all countries. In the UK they don't have it still, believe it or not, but we have it in South Africa. So have a look at this. This is a view that we haven't ever seen before. We've got a guide wire within the biliary system, and you'll see me flick around now to see the actual hilum. It almost looks bronchoscopy. There you go. Do you see the hilum? Where you see the left and the right ducts, the anterior sexual duct, the posterior sexual duct, you can see a whole lot of bile coming through there. And you can now use this camera to selectively cannulate which duct you want to get into. Previously we couldn't do this. We honestly couldn't do this. I'm going to come back just now on the camera, and you're going to see a stone that was impacted that I used a laser to break up and then pull out of the bile duct. So this patient didn't have to undergo major surgery besides removal of the gallbladder. Didn't have to have a knife, didn't have to have a bile duct open, and so the morbidity and mortality was reduced significantly. We'll soon come back with the camera. Prof. Bizos was there, he's a mentor of mine, a friend, and he was watching this. And that little duct at the bottom there that you see is one of the caudate lobe branches. We never had an idea that that's what it looked like. We can understand why cancer spread so early through these things with new technology, and why we need to resect certain parts of the caudate lobe, etc. But as I come back now, you'll see that's a left duct that you see. That's the anterior central duct, the posterior central duct, and the bridge of tissue between them. And I'm going into the posterior central duct there. So that's deep in the liver. That's deep, deep in the liver that we're actually getting a view of what's going on. So there you go. As I pull back, what is that? That round structure is a stone in the common bile duct. So we never were able to do that before. Now, the advent of spyglass, etc., we can use a laser. We get a laser up against that, we can shatter that stone, and we can remove it by putting up a new back over that guide wire. So that's what the inside of the bile duct looks like when there's stones. So you saw a normal looking bile duct with a stone floating in. How about, what does a tumor look like? A Klatskin tumor. Who knows what a Klatskin tumor is? It's a tumor of the bile duct that occurs at the confluence of the bile duct. Commonest type of cholangiocarcinoma one might get. So, oops, if we have a look at this guy, so let's just go back to Project Library. This I did last night, by the way. So this is hot off the press. Have a look at that. Do you see the difference of the bile duct? It's all ragged and jaded, as opposed to that nice sort of cylindrical appearance that you had. Those are fronds of tumor that are pointing at you from within the bile duct. We never knew what it looked like previously, but now we can actually see. And within this framework, we can take little pieces of tissue through that channel, like I showed you with the biopsy forceps, and we send them to the laboratory testing. So I'm still waiting for this result, which will probably be ready tomorrow. But this is what we're looking at in terms of spyglass and advancing technology to enhance surgery. So I'm not going to fiddle too much more with this, except to say, have any of you seen an ERCP? Okay, so these are, this is a combination of an ERCP and a spyglass to show you how we push the boundaries now in dealing with stone disease and learning and biopsies and these tumors within the bile duct. If I go back here, I thought what we could do is, let's stop for a minute, and this is quite sort of intense, I think, maybe too high level stuff, so let's go back to our patient. Let's look at our patient, and how's this? A 55-year-old female presents with obstructive jaundice in 2 weeks. What are the hallmark features? Can I ask questions? No? I'm more intimidated by you, I promise you, at the moment, really. So just feel free to, like, just answer if it's right or wrong.
Yes, sir. My name is Adam. I'm a first year medicine. I just wanted to ask, prior to these quite advanced technological processes to doing, what was the normal way in which a surgeon would have gone into something as small as a bile duct to take out the stone?
So what we used to do is we used to do an ERCP.
Yeah.
We used to put that same guide wire up. Over that guide wire we used to inject dye, and we would see where the level of the obstruction is. We still do this.
You see that from the outside?
You see it on screening on x-ray. So when you inject dye, we then take an x-ray picture, and we'll see where the blockage is. Over that guide wire, we would then put a brush, like a milk bottle brush. It looks like that, except it's minute. And that goes up, and we would brush that area at the screening, because we'd see where the blockage is, and we'd send those cells onto the laboratory. The problem with brushing was that if it came back positive, we knew it was definitely a cancer. If it came back negative, it wasn't really good. It doesn't mean that there's not a cancer there. So it's very specific, but sensitivity was very poor.
I see. And now, why were you required to be more qualified and more experienced in South Africa to carry out such procedures as compared to other countries, as you alluded to, like you said, other countries only a physician would be able to do such.
So endoscopy is going towards the role everywhere else in the world, except one or two countries, that there are medical gastroenterologists, and the medical gastroenterologists do the screening colonoscopies, the gastroscopies, they do the endoscopic ultrasounds, and they do the ERCPs. In our country, for some reason or the other, it's traditionally been the surgeon that is involved with gastroscopies, colonoscopies, and ERCPs. They really led the field in this way, and we continue to push it in that way. The reason is that an upper GIB comes in the middle of the night. The physicians in general are not always available in the middle of the night to deal with that need. The surgeons tend to be on site. They tend to have the skills to scope patients. And when endoscopy fails, they need to operate on those patients to stop the bleeding, to save their lives. So surgery in this country still has a huge role in the endoscopic field. And I think it will continue for the next few years. Yes,
sir. Where did you get the training before that? Because I assume you qualified before that was there. And how many people are trained to do it like you guys do, like here in South Africa? Like how many hospitals can do it?
So there are very few people in the country doing quite a bit of hospital, and I think I can count it on maybe one hand. So I think that's quite a bit of hospital getting using spyglass games and Valda. I'm one of them that does it in Johannesburg. In 2 weeks, Osani Garibanov does it, and Sean Bokchuk in hospital. Thomas Murillo does a few things. And obviously, I do probably get all one or two other surgeons that do it. But it's one of the clinical trials that I ran to bring it into the country.
And where did you train for that? Did you have to go back to America or?
No, actually, that's a very good question. The truth is that I had ERCP skills, and to convert those ERCP skills to using a spyglass wasn't very difficult or challenging. So I have to say that I watched a few videos, I spoke to a few people, and I started to do it. And we did it in a safe environment, and we learned together how to use it. In fact, last year, October, there was a guy from Australia, his name is Paul Edwards. Professor Paul Edwards, who came out and gave us a talk, and he was an expert called on colonoscopy to talk to us about. And he gave his experience of doing 50 cases of the spyglass, using the spyglass. There are lots of people that were doing different types of colonoscopy before. They're different types of scopes. Very difficult to use, not very successful, and some people abandoned it. We had two operators, etc., which wasn't as good as it is now. And he gave his experience, and he was talking about an experience of like 75 to 50 cases. And we're beyond that at this stage. So we were just lucky at the right time, at the right place, and we got the information we were able to run. Any other questions? So we're getting back to our patient, right? So let's say this is a Friday night at Chris Hardy Barry Barnum Hospital, because this is Colin. You're going to be there soon, and if you're not there already, and you're going to see this, that a 55-year-old female comes with an obstructive jaundice for about 2 weeks. Now, she had new onset fevers, rigors, and right upper quadrant pain. Who's a GMP3? Are there any? No? Who's a GMP4? None? Who's a GMP2? Okay, wonderful. So, in terms of clinical skills, what we teach, is this triad. Have you heard of this triad? Fever, right upper quadrant pain, and jaundice. This is so important because it's a clinical diagnosis of cholangitis. Okay. Have you heard of cholangitis before? So, cholangitis is basically a blocked system, blocked biliary system. So nothing's getting out of the liver, out of the bile ducts. You can't get rid of the bile. There's an obstruction to the flow of bile. That bile gets infected. That's a lethal condition that, if left untreated, leads to death. Septic shock and death. So it's a serious condition. So this lady comes in with this new onset of fevers, rigors, right up front pain. Her white blood cell count, normal, is less than 12. Hers is 18.89. Her hemoglobin levels are 12.9, which are okay. And her platelets are normal. Her kidney function is reasonable. But look at a liver function test. So total bilirubin, which normal is less than 21, is sitting at 168. She's canary yellow. What we can see from these blood results is that her total bilirubin to direct or conjugated bilirubin level is more than 50%, which implies that it's obstructive jaundice. If it's a medical jaundice, we'll have a lower direct proportion. So it would be less than 50% conjugated bilirubin. You guys are all with me on that. Good. We look at a ductal enzyme, so ALP is very high, and so is a GGT. And the transaminases are a bit up, which doesn't really say that it's hepatic pathology, but it tells you that she's probably got cholangitis. Her INR is also deranged. Now, why is her INR deranged? Important question, and I promise you'll get asked this in the exams. Yes, sir.
Her hepatic function is diminished, so she's not making coagulation factors.
So I would suggest that if you've got a tap, okay, and you turn the tap on, and you've got a hose pipe attached to the tap, okay, the tap in the liver, and then I take the hose pipe and I tie a knot in it. Is there a problem with the tap? No. So the synthetic function of the liver is in the early stages preserved, but if you continue having that back pressure, the tap may break. You may get cirrhosis over time, but that takes years to do it. So in the initial phases, what does bile do? Right, because bile comes down into the gut through the ampulla of Vata, right? You guys remember that, so bile comes through and it goes into the gut. And it emulsifies the fat to allow for fat absorption. Now, there are certain fat-soluble vitamins. And those fat-soluble vitamins are vitamins A, D, D, E. Okay, thank you so much. I'm getting worried here, guys. Vitamin A, D, E, and K. And because you can't absorb fat, that means you can't absorb vitamin K. And you have certain clotting factors that are vitamin K dependent. And those clotting factors are factors 2, 7, 9, and 10. Wonderful. So the clotting factors are there. They all are there. They need a coenzyme, which is vitamin K, to activate them. So then, how do we treat this patient? Because we need to do some intervention on her, and we worry she's going to bleed, right? So, how do we treat her? Give her vitamin K. The question is, how do we give vitamin K? Intravenously is wonderful, or intramuscularly. Okay, you can give both, but I think intravenously is kinder. Okay. when babies are born, the first thing they do is they get a jab. They normally get a jab of vitamin K. Okay. But you don't have to give it intramuscularly. We all give it intravenously, I think, more than anything else. And we give a 10 milligram shot for 3 days consecutively. And most of the time, that corrects the factor. But she can't wait because she's sick. She needs urgent intervention. So how do you know that this is medical jaundice? Well, you want to see what happens when you tie a knot in the hose pipe. One side is collapsed, and the other side starts to blow up. If you see those cartoon Tom and Jerry sort of thing, you see that hose pipe gets huge, you know, on the one side. And that's what happens to the bile ducts. So above the level of the blockage, the bile ducts swell up. Below it, they remain collapsed. So what do we do to see that? We do an ultrasound, which is now becoming an extension of our hands, our typical hands. So we do an ultrasound. And the ultrasound shows dilated bile ducts within the liver and outside the liver. No dilated pancreatic duct, and I'll talk to you about it later, and gallstones. There are certain cases that we just can't get out because the stones are too large. So management of a large problem bile duct stone. So in that case, I can use a spyglass, a laser, I can fracture the stone, but sometimes the stones are just too big, so I really can't deal with it. So there's an ERCP. Now this is an x-ray picture, do you see that? You were asking earlier. Here's your x-ray picture. Here's this camera that I drew on that side, coming down the esophagus, going into the duodenum. There's my guide wire. The black bit is bile duct that I've injected, a whole lot of dye inside. And there's a big filling defect there. Do you see that? A huge filling defect. Does everybody see that and appreciate that? That filling defect is a stone. It's a massive stone. There's no way I'm going to, you saw how small that entrance is? There's no way I'm going to be able to pull that out. So we tried spyglass, and the stone was too hard to shatter with laser. So what do I do, guys? Trouble. What can we do? The stage. Any ideas? Don't be shy. We're all interested in the eggs. You want to do surgery. What kind of surgery do you have to do? Do open surgery? Do laparoscopic surgery? What should we do? Laparoscopic. Because it was me, I'd want laparoscopic. Except she said that the surgeon thought it would be good laparoscopic because it's very challenging to do this. But if you mess it up, the morbidity and mortality are rated really high. So you get one crack at the apple and you don't want to injure the bile duct or the pancreas. So we decided we would operate on her. And we were very excited by this. Maybe I should just show you, shall I give you some sound effects? Because that might make you realize what it's like in theater. And then we also kind of got kids at heart. So that's a bile duct opened. There's a bit of blood there, but that's a bile duct open, and you can see the stone, that exact stone that you saw there, stuck in a bile duct. And no matter what I do, I'm trying to get it out. So we were all super excited. So let's just, and then I repaired the bile duct here laparoscopically, stitching it laparoscopically. And you can see it looks really, really nice repaired. But I think it's worth another view because I don't think you kind of get a full appreciation of what's going on the first time. So bile ducts are opened, you're struggling to get that out. And suddenly I get a good grip. And we're all very excited when this thing comes out. So we're very, 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 very excited when it came out because it was hard work. Very rewarding, to be honest, to be actually brought this up. And this was in our infancy when we were starting to learn from bile duct inspiration. Now that blood that you saw isn't a lot. It's all magnified, okay? So it's 10 times what your eye would normally see. So it's really not a lot of blood. The patient was fine, she didn't turn out dead. Okay? So I thought that would be an interesting thing for you to see. Can we do another case? Do we have time? I'm running out of time.
Sure.
Okay. So this was a wonderful case for me because it was a 54-year-old male patient who presented with non-variceal upper GI TB. Who knows the definition of what an upper GI TB is? Anybody? So it's bleeding from the foregut, okay? So it's from anywhere above ligamentum tritus. Everybody knows where ligamentum tritus is? It's the duodenal jejunal flexure. So anything above the duodenal jejunal flexure is deemed the upper GI bleed. So that's what he presented with, him vomiting bright red blood. And we knew that it wasn't a variceal bleed based on his history and having signs of liver failure, but that's what was our working diagnosis. His pulse was 96 beats a minute. His temperature was 36.8. His respiratory rate was okay. His blood pressure was normal. He was a non-smoker, which is a risk factor for smoking, peptic ulcer disease. And he didn't use any non-steroidal or anti-inflammatories. Okay. Also a risk factor. So he didn't really have many risk factors. So why is a healthy 54-year-old now vomiting blood? There's a whole host of differentials. And so we need to say, what can we do? One thing that I want to bring to you, I was asked to talk a little bit about anatomy, and I was asked to talk a little bit about physiology. And so here's a bit of physiology for you here. It's if you look at his urea, which is part of his kidney function test, it's 17.8. Normal is less than 6. And creatinine is 134. Normal is less than 110, depending on which lab you use. But you can see that his urea is markedly elevated. That's because he's swallowing some of the blood that's going through. He's digesting the blood, and reabsorption of the digested blood gives you a high urea. Okay. So that confirms that he's got a GIB. The other thing that confirms it is that the patient has melena. Has anyone heard about melena? No? Melena is black, tarry stool, and it smells. When the patient is bleeding, it's the action of the acid on the blood that turns it black. So we know straight away that the patient has an upper GI bleed when we see that. It's liver function test. So I did an upper endoscopy, and this is in the stomach where you can see all these folds. Down at the bottom here, you see this huge tumor. Anybody has any idea? I promise you now, give me the right answer, you 10,000 rand on the right answer. Right now, promise.
That's the question.
The tumor is this. It's a special tumor, and it's a spot diagnosis, you see it.
Good enough.
You know what? There's money on it. Say anything, it doesn't matter. Looks like a little balloon, but no. So the common, well, some of the common tumors that we get in the stomach is gastric adenocarcinoma. But this is not a gastric adenocarcinoma. See, the mucosa on top of it looks normal, isn't it? It's just bleeding from the spot here where it's ulcerated. Looks like it's coming from deeper down, pushing up and growing from the muscle layers. So there's a special, yes.
Would it be instant lymphoma?
So lymphoma, you can get lymphoma in the gut, but this is not lymphoma. Yes, sir.
The leiomyoma.
So that's almost right. That's what we used to call them, is leiomyomas. So you almost won 10,000 rand. We call this a gist. Gastrointestinal stromal tumor. Have you heard of those? Has anyone heard of those? Yeah. So it arises from special cells. And this is specifically for you guys because I've been asked to talk about some anatomy as well. It arises from special cells called the interstitial cells of Kajal. And those are the pacemaker cells that allow peristalsis to develop. So this is a very specialized tumor. It's so exciting when you find one of these. This is a CT scan. And the interesting thing about these tumors is they have a propensity to grow exophytically, so outside, and endophytically inside. Yes, sir?
Would you make that diagnosis just by DNA as well?
No, you need a biopsy to confirm it, and it stains positive for CD117, or a tyrosine kinase, a c-kit mutation. But when we see it, because it's so classic, we know immediately what it is. So it's almost like a spot diagnosis. When I saw this, it was a complete spot diagnosis. So what do you think we did? We did a CT scan, and on the CT scan, here's the stomach. Here's the endophytic component that you saw, but look how much is lying outside. It's quite a significant amount lying outside the stomach as well. So it's growing in and outside. But it hasn't invaded any other organs. So, what are we going to do? We need to cut it out. Right? We're very close to there. Normally, we just need to cut it out with a 2 centimeter margin. But it's very close to the gastric outlet, and like had a 2 centimeter margin, I would narrow the pylorus. So I had to make a decision about what to do. So, what I did do was a laparoscopic gastrectomy. So I'm sorry if that doesn't project very well. But what we have is an artery there. This is the duodenum on this side. I'm going under the duodenum. The stomach's at the top, and there's a tumor there. Do you see it? We're going around the back of the stomach. Hopefully you'll see my instrument come out. Sometime. Soon there. You see my instrument come out. It's not projecting very well. But you can see the duodenum there. And I'm underneath it, so I'm then going to come around, and you'll see the tumor now. Yeah, sorry, the glare is quite bad. I see that the visuals aren't that great. But there's the tumor. Do you see it hanging off the edge? You see it as we come back. Where's it back there? There's the tumor. And so I'll mobilize the stomach on this one. All the way around in the back. So, there's the tumor in the corner hanging towards us. You can see it. Then I fire staplers across to transect it and move the stomach through the keyholes. It's quite amazing to get this done, and it's really magnificent to satisfying when you do this. And that's what makes surgery so nice. Yes?
How long surgery did it take?
Well, it was actually quite quick. It was probably about an hour and a half to finish. It wasn't that long. Yeah. Some of the surgeries that I do open surgery, and I'm just showing you the advances. I do a lot of open surgery as well. And when I do things like pancreatic or duodenectomy to remove pancreatic cancers, those take me about 6-7 hours to take out. Yeah, long surgery, but wonderful, very rewarding.
So would you have to empty out the digestive tract completely before you start?
Not at all. We actually make them starve overnight and the stomach's empty. And when you go into operating, we get the anesthetist to put in a gastric tube once the patient's asleep and sucks out air or any fluid that's there. Most of the time the solids have gone. There's a lot of evidence about whether you should do your patient bowel prep or no bowel prep in terms of colorectal surgery. Colon, rectum, you know that that's where the biggest load of bacteria sits. Right side and stuff, I don't give one. In fact, I don't give my patients bowel prep any longer. I operate on the stuff. Okay, so, but it's a back and forth thing, so I don't want to give you too much difference about that. So, would you like to see something that you guys might do more sooner than I would? There's a laparoscopic appendicectomy. So, maybe I can show you that. So, laparoscopic appendicectomy. I'm going to stop talking. I think I've spoken too much now. I might be boring you. So in here, doing this through a lap scope, here you can see that small bowel being moved away. And down in the pelvis, that's the pelvis down at the bottom here. This is the pelvis there and the bladder. You can see there's a bit of fluid down at the bottom there. But there is a big, ugly looking thing there. That's an appendix that's in there, that's swollen. Do you see that? There's normal appendix at the bottom there, but there's something huge inside there. And so we're just going to burn across the appendiceal artery pottery or dyed film. It's just really interesting that we use it to burn as we go across, separating the appendix from the cecum, or actually at that point that's probably a good terminal alignment that we push it away. There you can see that's the base of the appendix here. And that's the cecum. This is something called an endo loop that we use. And we'll pull this appendix through the endo loop to seal the bowel. You see the drive at the base. Second one to make sure that the stuff doesn't leak from the other side. Note how it's like really bloodless surgery. Well, maybe I was being a little bit over-sensitive, so I was a bit worried to put two at the bottom. That's a big tumor, I was a bit intimidated by it. So we use laparoscopic shears, scissors, to cut through it. Then we put it in a bag to get rid of it. We put it in the bag before we cut it fully. We don't get too much spillage, if anything spills. Very meticulously, they're using the pottery to kill the mucosa there. And boom! Oh, yeah. I had a bit of bleeding. Oh dear. We found the area. We settled it down. Just with that. The key is not to panic when it bleeds. That was good. Now we zip it up.
Aye.
There you go. And then we pull it out. Through the port. Here it comes. Gonna deliver this baby. Sucking out some of the stuff to make it easier for it to come. And then, you can see the mucus inside of it. Give it another tug. Squeeze. And then pop. Out she comes. So, yes, ma'am.
Just a random question. What's your view on the appendix? Do we need it or don't we?
I think it's a very valid question. You speak to some of the pediatric surgeons in very early years, they haven't even had certain immune function and they don't need it. You should really be filled with it. So you don't fiddle with it unless you have to take it out. But you don't really need it. It's like the gallbladder. You don't really need it to survive. But leave it alone in this. Alright, so I think I've spoken a little bit too much. So as much as some things change, and this is a picture of three weeks ago, standing in Mainz, Germany, behind the Da Vinci robot. That's a Da Vinci robot. And we were fiddling and playing with it. As much as things change, some things remain the same. And the basics of surgery and the basics of human anatomy, the basics of physiology are so important.